This is a training video to set up your new radio detection transmitter. All the transmitters look pretty close to being the same. They come in a 1 watt, a 3 watt, a 5 watt, or a 10 watt package. The only difference is on the 10 watt you have additional frequencies like current direction frequencies that allow you to understand which way your current's running on the line. And some of the units can be ordered with iLock that allows you to remotely control the transmitter frequency and the power level from the receiver, up to about 300 feet away or so. Now this unit here is a 10 watt package with the iLock feature on it, so it's going to have some additional features not found possibly on your 3 watt or 5 watt unit. But the setup process is about the same. All the units will come right back on to the frequency that you had it on last when you turn it on. So we're on a 512 hertz frequency right now. So your frequency is displayed there. Your output level is displayed here, battery life, milliamps, which is basically telling you how good of continuity you have on your hookup when you're using your direct connect leads, and your output voltage. The voltage will go up when you have bad continuity. For example, here we're not hooked on to anything, so our milliamps is at zero, which means our voltage has to try to turn itself up to compensate for the bad continuity. Now the milliamps and the voltage do not display when you're in an induction mode. So if I unplug the cables, it will go into induction mode where it just throws a signal underneath the box, and you can apply your signal by placing the box over the item you want to locate. You can see the animation on the screen is letting me know it's in induction mode now, and I won't have all the frequencies to select from. You'll see that the 512 Hz will not show up on the screen. Because when you're in induction mode, you're purposely trying to bleed signal into the line, so you have to use a higher frequency that bleeds off. The lower frequencies are much better for hooking up direct, and so when I plug the cables back in, you can see it automatically went back to the 512 Hz that I preferred to use when I was using the direct connect leads last. It's a smart transmitter and it remembers where you like to operate, so it eliminates having to go through a setup process every time you plug in a different appendage or turn the unit on. So if I wanted to just use 512 Hz for a majority of the time on two bars of output, I could shut the unit off and go to my next locate, turn it back on, and I'm set to go, as long as I'm matched up on the receiver to the same frequency. So the frequencies show up on the middle of the screen here, and you choose your frequency by pushing the F key. There's 8 kHz, 9.8 kHz, 33 kHz, 65 kilohertz, 83, and higher and higher. The higher frequency should be reserved for times that you have high resistance on a line. When there's a low resistant line, you want to stay low on your frequency so you don't bleed off onto other lines that are around you. The 512 hertz is one of the better choices, and 8 kilohertz is also widely used. So 512 and 8, but I'm missing the current direction frequencies that are lower than 512 right now. And the reason why is because I've turned them off in the menu system. You can control what frequencies you do or do not want to show up on the main screen by going into the menu system and turning them on or off. You get into the menu system by pushing the on-off key real quick. If you hold the on-off key down, it will shut the unit down. But by pushing it real quick, now I can scroll through the menu. The first thing on the menu is volume, but I'm going to scroll until I see the word frequency, or FREQ, which stands for frequencies. I can go into this option on the menu by pushing the V key, which is also my right arrow. The F key is a left arrow that will get you back out of the menu. So I'm going to go into the option of frequencies, and the first option that comes up is AKFF. That stands for 8 kHz fault find mode. If you're using an A-frame with your package to determine where the cable fault is, you would use AKFF. If you do not have an A-frame attachment, then you won't use AKFF, so you can go ahead and go into it by hitting the V key and turning it to the off position if it's not there already. Once I'm at off, I can hit the F key and toggle back one step, and now I'm going to toggle up to go to my next frequency. Now we're on 256. This is my first current direction frequency, so I'm going to go ahead, toggle into it, turn it on, toggle back one step, And now you can see if I hit the back arrow one more time, I'm back to the regular frequency part of the menu. I hit it one more time, I'm back to the regular screen. So when now I go through my frequencies, I will see 512 and 256 show up. There's 256, and then there's 512. If I want to toggle back to 256, I do not have to scroll all the way back through all the frequencies again. I can simply just hold down the F key and hit the down arrow to toggle back one step. So you can go individually to each frequency and turn it on or off depending on if you want it displayed or not. So if I go back to the frequency choices, you can see there is a whole bunch of frequencies underneath my frequency menu. 256, 285, 320, 380, 460. All those are current direction frequencies, and then we get into your lower end frequencies, 512, 570, 577. And so there may be a certain frequency that you like to use, or maybe you just try to use a frequency a little different than another guy that's locating in the same area. That's how you turn those frequencies on and off. Now, the next thing on the buttons is your V key. The V key stands for voltage, of course, and what we normally have displayed on the screen is your milliamps and voltage. If I push the V key, it will move over to kilo-ohms. It's measuring the impedance value of what we're hooked up to. So if you're on a high resistant line, like we are now, you'll get a high resistant reading. We have an OL, stands for over limit right now, because we're not hooked onto anything. If I would short these leads together, you'll see my ohms go to zero. So now we have no resistance whatsoever. And if I go back to my milliamp reading, you can see my milliamps are higher. Before we were at zero and our voltage was at 30. Now we're at 71 milliamps and our voltage is at zero because the voltage doesn't need to turn itself up to try to compensate for the bad continuity. Now if you have bad continuity, I'm just going to go to 33 kilohertz here, and when you have bad continuity, in this case I'm just taking those leads and opening them up, you're going to see the voltage go up and try to push out more milliamps, and it's going to max out at 30 volts. Now there's an option to change this transmitter to a high voltage mode, which will allow it to put out 90 volts. The 90 volts will help push out current in times that you have high resistance on the utility that you're hooked up to, or maybe there's high resistance on the return path, the dirt that you're grounded to. And so when there's dry ground, or possibly that utility is just a bad conductor, you may want to use the high voltage mode to get more milliamps to travel down that line. So I'm going to push the on-off key quick, go into that menu, and scroll until I see max voltage. Now I push the right arrow to go into that and toggle it from low to high, and then back out of that menu system by hitting the left arrow here, or the frequency button. Now you'll see there's a lightning bolt that showed up on the screen, but what you're going to see here is it move up to 30 volts and then switch, and now it's going up to 90 and eventually will max out at 90 volts. Even though I'm not hooked on to anything, you can see what happened. Now I have 1 milliamp worth of current going down that line. It's actually completing a circuit by jumping the air gap between these two alligator clips because we threw out more voltage. This is something that's unique with the radio detection unit. The extra voltage really helps in times that you need to get the power or the current to travel down that line. So the really tough locates can be manageable as long as you're able to turn up that voltage. So that's your high voltage. If I turn the unit off and turn it back on, it will always reset back to 30 volts as a safety precaution so nobody gets shocked at the end of those leads. The next option is your up-down arrows. That controls your output level. Now there's basically 6 different output levels. If I go all the way down, you can see I'm not pushing out anything at all. And I know it because I have 0 milliamps and 0 volts. If I go to 1 bar, it's going to try to push out 10 milliamps. I'm going to go ahead and short these cables back together so you can get more of a real image of what you'll see in the field. And go to 8 kilohertz. Okay, So on 8 kilohertz on one bar of output, we are now at 5 milliamps. If I go up to 2 bars of output, it's going to go to 20 milliamps. 3 bars of output, it's going to go to 100 milliamps. But this is all relative to how good of continuity you have on the line that you're hooked up to, and how good of a ground you have too. It's trying to complete a circuit, and so the milliamps is letting you know that it's completing a circuit, and it's letting you know how good of a circuit it's completing. 100 milliamps is a good signal. If I go up to 4 bars of output, it's going to try to go to 500 milliamps. More than likely, you won't see that happen in the field because you have too much resistance on that line. But 500 milliamps would be an excellent signal that would go several miles. But I'm still not turned up all the way. I'm not using the full 10 watts of power. On the 10 watt package, you have a boost mode. And so to get into boost, you have to hold down the up key, and you'll see the word boost come up on the screen. Now it's using all 10 watts of power, pushing out 500 milliamps, and that will suck your batteries down pretty quick. And so there's a timer built into this boost mode where you can go into the menu system by hitting the on-off key, scroll till you see the word boost, and set the timer to 5 minutes, 10 minutes, or 20 minutes. And then after that timer's gone up, it will turn the boost back down automatically to conserve your battery life. Most of the time you don't need the boost on. You're just wasting battery. Most of your locates should not use more than 2 or 3 bars of output. When you're pushing out more power, your possibilities of bleeding off onto other utilities becomes greater and greater. So you want to try to keep the output as low as possible for most of your locates. Now the other options within the menu are your volume, where you can go and turn your volume up or down. I'm just going to scroll through here. There's your Bluetooth option. If you have the iLock feature because you bought the PDL Series B, you will be able to pair the two together and remotely control your transmitter from the receiver by getting into the Bluetooth functionality. Max voltage, which we've already covered, switches it to 90 volts of power output. And model type. This will match up the model type receiver that you're using with the transmitter, which will help match up your frequencies so you don't have to individually go into each frequency and turn it on or off. If I go into model type, you'll see that I'm able to match this up to a PDL style RD8000, PXL RD8000, a TL RD7000, a PL, and a DL RD7000. And the last option, well, it's an SL RD7000, and the last option is your RD4000 style receiver. So I'm just going to leave it on PDL for now. And then to my next option, after model type, is max power. If I wanted to conserve battery life, I can go into max power and turn this 10-watt transmitter down to a 5-watt, 3-watt, 2-watt, or 1-watt. The next option after max power is battery type. These are normally shipped with alkaline batteries, but if I wanted to use the rechargeable lithium ion battery, I would have to go into this menu and change it from alkaline. There's a nickel metal hydride option, and there's my lithium ion. Now that I'm on lithium ion, my battery indicator will be correct. If you accidentally had it on the wrong battery type, you'd still be able to locate just fine, but your battery meter would probably not read correctly. As you can see, now I switched it to lithium ion. I'm running alkaline batteries, but my battery meter shows that I'm a little low. If I go back to my alkaline option, it will more than likely change my battery meter, and it will possibly go back up again. So, after battery type, you have the optimal frequency. This will go in and select a frequency for you. It looks at the impedance or the resistance level of each frequency and picks one for you. I most of the time do not use that because I like to purposely use a low frequency to eliminate bleed off. Language, to change the language from English to Spanish to German or whatever you're practicing. And boost mode, that will turn on the timer for the boost option, and back to frequency, which we've already covered. So those are all your different options in the menu screen of your transmitter. Your transmitter comes complete with 20-foot cable leads, a 20-foot spool of jumper wire to jumper out your ground rod further away from your transmitter, a spiral ground rod, and a magnet to magnetize onto certain objects that you don't have a hookup point on. If you have any other questions, feel free to contact us by phone or email. Thank you.